When you first update to macOS Tahoe, it might not look like there's a lot different in the latest operating system, but as soon as you dive a little deeper, either looking at Spotlight, in the Control Center, or especially Shortcuts, you'll find that this is actually a huge upgrade with some powerful features under the hood. Not to mention the entirely new liquid glass redesign across the operating system, some features that you might have also seen on iOS like translation and messages and across different apps, and some small quality of life improvements like password history. And while it's not perfect, I do think macOS Tahoe is a huge step forward, but still leaves a lot of room for great third-party utilities, and in the end, I'll show you how to take advantage of some of the powerful automations now in Shortcuts. This is my macOS Tahoe review. Now, like iOS 26 and the other operating systems, liquid glass redesign has touched everything, from the menu bar, which can now be completely transparent, to the control center with those liquid glass effects, allowing you to see the wallpaper or other content behind those controls. And if you choose, you can really go all the way with liquid glass and even change your dock icons to be that transparent effect. Now, I actually like the transparent menu bar, but I wasn't about the clear icons in the dock because it also affects those icons here in system settings, and I find it's actually visually more difficult to find what I'm looking for when everything's the same color. But you can go to Appearance and choose either the tinted icons, like you can on iPhone and iOS, or just use the default icons, which many have been updated, especially Apple's first-party icons, to have that little glass effect. Now, an app you probably use all the time and definitely looks different with that liquid glass redesign is Safari. If you visit a regular web page, you still have the typical tab navigation here and the toolbar, and if you prefer, you can still go up to the View menu and you can show your favorites bar. That might start looking more familiar or what you're used to. And depending on the website you're visiting, that color will carry into the toolbar and even your favorites bar. There's also updated animations throughout the OS, like nice little animations for Spotlight, and we'll be coming back to that because there's some powerful features there. You'll also notice more animations and redesigns in things like messages, especially with wallpapers you can now adjust per conversation, and little features like translating messages and full conversations. I talked a lot about new features that actually go across the operating systems in my iOS 26 review. I'll put that up here. But let's get into some features that are specifically on the Mac. The first one being Control Center. While it might just look like a visual redesign, Control Center is actually a lot more powerful and allows you to create multiple panes of controls. So when I click Edit Controls here, I can drag widgets and actions into the control center here on the right side. Let's take keyboard brightness, for example, drag that in, and now I can control it here. But you'll also notice at the very top in the menu bar, there's now a plus icon. When you click that, you can actually create an entirely new control center and then have controls that are tailored to you. Put a bunch of shortcuts here in the menu bar and more. If you use a lot of shortcuts on your Mac, you might have had the shortcuts menu bar, which was quick access to often used shortcuts. And you can still do that if you go to the shortcuts down here, you can add the show menu bar collection, and I can add it to control center. But in macOS Tahoe, it's even easier to drag controls here from control center up into the menu bar for permanent access. So if you wanted Wi-Fi up here in the menu bar, I can just drag that control and it appears here now permanently in the bar. I can also drag it right back out, no keyboard shortcut or hotkey needed to move those. I also moved my menu bar collection of shortcuts here into the menu bar, like it was in macOS Sonoma. One thing I did notice, it does take significantly longer to access those shortcuts that I placed in the menu bar. When I click it here, it takes several seconds. I won't do any cuts here so you can see how long it takes. And then I see my menu of shortcuts right here. That was several seconds. And then here on my Mac Studio, which still has macOS Sequoia, when I click that menu bar for shortcuts, it is instantaneous. I don't have to wait at all, and then I can click a shortcut to run it. I'm hoping maybe that will improve over time. I also find it launch sometimes faster, like it did just then, and sometimes it takes a few seconds. So maybe it's a bug in shortcuts. Those happen frequently, to be honest. But let's talk about the other big improvement in macOS Tahoe, which is Spotlight. Command space still launches Spotlight, or you can click it in the menu bar. But now when you click the right arrow on your keyboard, you get access to application shortcuts, which has replaced Launchpad if you had used that previously, access or searching files and folders, the entire shortcuts action, and also your clipboard. Clipboard history has been a long time coming. Apple has never had a first-party clipboard history option. But if I go to my clipboard history, you'll see there are no results. That's because it will only save the last 8 hours of clippings, and then it will wipe your clipboard history. And for those reasons, I think a lot of third-party utilities still have many years of life left. I still use PasteBot as my clipboard manager. It lives up here in the menu bar. I can always refer back to different links that I've copied and pasted. I can search my entire history, and PasteBot will save not just a number of hours of clippings, but I can tell it to save all the way up to 100 or 1,000 past clippings, no matter how long it's been. Now, if we go back into Spotlight, you can quickly access the clipboard or other tabs by pressing Command 3, Command 4, and Command 2. You can combine that so you can do Command Space and Command 1, and you're immediately in your applications. Command Space and Command 2, and you're searching your files. Spotlight is still how I launch many of my applications. I rarely go to the dock. I'll usually just start typing an application, hit enter, and that application will open. But there's another new feature here in Spotlight, which is called Quick Keys. Now you'll find it under the Actions menu, and it looks like the Shortcuts action because it actually works with shortcuts. And again, we'll get to shortcuts at the end of the video. But here, there's actually lots of actions that you can take using what Apple is calling Quick Keys. So you can send a message by just typing the letters SM, a recipient and message, and never even open the Messages app. So for instance, I can do Command Space, SM, and then type, hey, let's go to lunch. I can then type a name of a recipient, even add multiple, and I never had to open the Messages app. If you take the time to program and learn a bunch of quick keys, you can actually do a lot of automations and actions right here in Spotlight. And just scrolling down the full list, you'll also see lots of third-party apps, and Apple's own apps like Notes allow you to program quick keys for all these actions. So you can choose to create a note, maybe I'll do NN for new note, and now when I invoke Spotlight, NN, and I'll immediately see Create Note, I can hit Enter, I can start typing the contents, choose a folder, and it will be created. Lastly, another very powerful feature of Spotlight is the ability to run shortcuts with drag and drop files or contextual awareness. I can type a title to one of my shortcuts that allows for Spotlight input, and I can input the file right here without actually opening shortcuts or running it from the menu bar. I run a ton of shortcuts this way, even like my app icon shortcut, which allows me to search for icons. It's already running. It asks me how many apps do I want. I just need one app. I can choose what platform to pull the icon from, and then I can search for whatever name I want. And then that saves the icon as an image to my desktop. So if you do anything once you install macOS Tahoe, it's spend some time with Spotlight, maybe program some quick keys, and of course build some shortcuts. Now going back to a Finder window, there are way more options for customizing folders here in macOS Tahoe. For instance, there's a customize folder option here in the contextual menu. And here you can choose the color of your folder, which can apply to tags, or you can have different tags per color of folder, and you can even put icons on the folder. You'll also notice those contextual menus in macOS Tahoe now have icons next to all these options, which again makes it easier to visually find exactly what you're looking for. Back in macOS Sequoia, right-clicking would bring up the contextual menu, but no icons. Also, if you use iCloud passwords like I do, there's a very welcome addition here, which is password history. If you go up to Passwords and then Settings, one, I would show the passwords in the menu bar. This way you can quickly access them here. And when you go to a specific login, you'll see a new View History option, so you can see previous passwords and when they were changed for this login. There is also a brand new phone app on the Mac. So now we have an iPhone app on iPhone, iPad, and the Mac. It has the new redesign with liquid glass, but honestly, it looks really good. You can call people from your Mac using Continuity. This also makes me want to put full poster images for all of my contacts, so this looks even better. And finally, before we get to some major shortcuts, live activities are now on the Mac. So not only will you get little statuses here in the menu bar, like when shortcuts are running in the background, files are downloading, and you'll also get live activities for things like following sports, DoorDash, Instacart, and you can see those right on your Mac, even if you don't have iPhone mirroring open. They'll appear here in the menu bar, and you can keep an eye on it whenever you'd like. But let's talk about the real star of macOS Tahoe, and that is shortcuts, for a couple reasons. Number one, we finally have automations on the Mac, and not just file and folder automations, lots of triggers, both time of day, when an email or message comes in, you can create automations around that. Lots of shortcut videos on my channel on how to take advantage of those, but also file and folder automations, with some really powerful sorting tools, when you connect a display or enable Stage Manager, when you open an app, battery level, and more, plus the focus mode automations as well. These automations, combined with the new Apple Intelligence actions, together, they are extremely powerful. I'll create a new shortcut here just to show you, but if you go to the Apple Intelligence actions here in Shortcuts, not only do you have the Apple Intelligence actions that you see in contextual menus, like summarize, rewrite text, proofread text, which those are great to have in shortcuts, this Use Model action is the one you want to experiment with. Couple reasons why. Number one, you can use Apple's own LLMs, their large language models, either private cloud compute, which accesses the internet. You can use an on-device model, meaning this shortcut can run even if you have no internet access and still use Apple Intelligence. Or, depending on the use case, you can actually use the ChatGPT extension but this is much more reliable and consistent than the ChatGPT app. Highly recommend trying this out. So I'll show you a couple examples of shortcuts that I have with these Apple Intelligence actions in mind. Number one, summarize audio file. One of the other actions that have been significantly improved in macOS Tahoe is their transcribe action. Previously, this would time out or error when you gave it a file that was too long, but that's not the case anymore. You can transcribe hours-long audio with this built-in action, no third-party app required, and then use the Apple Intelligence Use Model action to summarize, take action, whatever you'd like. Now, this shortcut I've actually made to be able to run in Spotlight, like I showed you before. It's in the Share sheet, and it's also in the Services menu when you two-finger or right-click on a file. So for instance, I can go to one of my Primary Tech Daily episodes. That's my tech podcast with Jason Aiton. New episodes every Friday. You should subscribe. I'll go to 2025, take this MP3 right here, and if I two-finger or right-click on this file, go down to Quick Actions, or this would be in the Services menu as well, my shortcut lives right here. When I click it, it's going to send that audio file to be transcribed by my shortcut. Then it will use Apple Intelligence to summarize it and create a bare note with that summary and full transcription all in one note. Again, with live activities, I can see that shortcut running here in the menu bar. Really appreciate seeing that progress so I know if it's stuck or not. It's prompting me to title it. I'll say PTS Daily Episode 84, tap done. And now I have a bare note with a summary of that audio file here, key points, again, using ChatGPT through Apple Intelligence, or I can change that to the private cloud compute model, and the full transcript that was completely done using the built-in shortcuts action. Now, two notes. When you try to use private cloud compute or the on-device model for Apple Intelligence, it will not work on text files that are very long, like 5,000 characters or more. That's why I have used ChatGPT here in this action. Also, this transcribe action does not function the same way on iPhone and iPad. It will not transcribe 1-2 hour audio files and more on your mobile device or iPad. But that's why I put it here in the macOS review because it's extremely powerful here. Now let's actually create a new shortcut because that use models action can actually take in a lot more than just text. So I'll add the use models action here at the top of the shortcut. Let's use Apple's private cloud compute for Apple Intelligence. So I'm gonna do a simple prompt like take this note and write a 500 word blog post about the content. Then I can search for Apple notes actions and I'll use the find notes action. I'll add a filter and say I only want notes from my folder of podcast summaries. I'm gonna add a choose from list action below that so I can choose which note I want. And then in the use model action, I can actually place that variable of the chosen note, and then it will run and actually make that blog post without me actually having to convert it to text or get text from input or anything like that. So if I run this shortcut, it should pull the Apple notes. I'll choose one here from the menu. It's going to send the text of that note to Apple Intelligence. And as you can see, it exceeded the maximum allowed length. That's one of the issues of using private cloud compute or the on-device model. So I'll switch it to the ChatGPT extension, choose the same Apple note, and there we now have a blog post. ChatGPT doesn't choke if the text is too long, and I can do whatever I want with that. The use model action, even with Apple Intelligence, can actually accept other kinds of media. So I'm gonna add a select photos option here. I'll choose an image from my photo library, and then here in the use models action, I can use that photo as part of the input. So I'll run this shortcut, choose a photo from my library. It is going to pass that photo through the Apple Intelligence action, and now it's going to give me a description of what was in that photo. Now, at the moment, the Apple Intelligence action can't output an image or photo, which is unfortunate because that would open up a whole world of possibilities. But you can expand the Use Models action, and in the output, you can see the different kinds of things it can output, whether that's a bulleted list, a Boolean yes, no, or even dictionary information that you can then pass to other actions after that. Also, this action can actually look inside files and folders to describe what's in them, even without taking action. So for instance, I'll add the file action here at the top. I'll choose ask each time so I can choose what file. And then I can say describe the contents of this file. So I'll run this shortcut. I can choose what file from the finder. I'll choose my media kit from the YouTube channel, hit done. And it's going to describe what's inside that file, not just the file name. And you can see it even broke down a bunch of information in plain text about that PDF. This is another powerful use case, input PDFs, get summaries through Apple Intelligence, rewrite, add it to notes, and more. Now, combine that with some of the automation actions, and you get some really powerful stuff. For instance, you can have an automation that when audio files are added to a specific folder, Apple Intelligence automatically transcribes, summarizes, and creates a new note. You can have automations when battery levels fall below a certain percent. I use push cuts to get a notification on my iPhone when my MacBook Air battery goes below 25%. You can also create automations when you connect to your home Wi-Fi, like turning on a focus mode, when an app is open or closed, and more. So just as an example, I'll choose app. Let's say when an app is opened, I'll choose compressor just for fun. I'll say I want this to run immediately. This is the same process that would be on the iPhone or iPad. I'll create a new shortcut so I have access to all the steps that I want. And maybe I just want to change to dark mode when I open that app. That's it. Now let me try to open compressor. And you'll see very quickly once that app opens, shortcuts went into dark mode. The entire computer did, and compressor opened up on my other screen. But as you can see, those automations for opening or closing apps work great. And one of the coolest use cases, and an easy one to show off, is because Apple Intelligence can look into your file contents, it can automatically sort files that you drop maybe on your desktop or other folders. So for instance, this automation right here, when files are dropped into a specific folder, it gets all the files that were in that folder, filters them, so this way it will only sort things with an RTF extension. You can eliminate the step if you wanted to. And then it's going to repeat this process with every file I dropped. Using Apple Intelligence, look at the contents of the document, and depending on what's inside the document, it's going to sort those things into different folders automatically. So to see this shortcut in action, here I have a folder called Auto Sort, and I have four folders there where I can organize things in personal, business, finance, and travel. Then I have four files here with various content, but I've titled the files just doc1234, so there's no chance Apple Intelligence is sorting this just by the title of the file. Now, when I drop these files into that auto sort folder, the shortcut is going to start running, looking at the contents of each file, figure out which one should go to which folder, and then automatically start sorting them one by one. You can see them moving into the different folders. It's asking permission for the first time. And then in just a few seconds, every file is in its respective folder automatically. Now you can have this automation run on your desktop, in your downloads folder, do things like convert videos to an audio file as soon as it hits your downloads folder, and a ton more. I have an entire video that's going to go into using Apple Intelligence with shortcuts across iOS and Mac. The video is coming very soon, so get subscribed and hit that like button. And when it comes to macOS Tahoe, I think little quirks like the shortcuts menu not running as fast in my menu bar, hopefully that will get fixed over subsequent versions, but the addition to clipboard history and spotlight with the smart keys and shortcuts actions with input, plus quality of life improvements like password history, all the features that come across messages and other Apple apps, and most importantly, the shortcuts actions that are incredibly powerful paired with those automations, I think macOS Tahoe is another solid update. Now, if you don't like liquid glass or that look, you can reduce the transparency overall like you can on iPhone, but I've been living with it for a couple months now, and so I would encourage you just to stick with it. I think if you give it some time, it might start growing on you. If you want to see my full review of iOS 26, I'll link that video right up here. And if you're ready to download iOS 26 and you want to know the first 10 features to try right off the bat, I have a video on that right up here. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you next time.